Hey everyone, I recently upgraded my graphics card to the NVIDIA RTX 5080, which is a brilliant graphics card in my testing so far, but the first thing I actually wanted to do was test out on my two normal computers, whatever normal is of course, and that's because a lot of the tech reviewers use the most powerful hardware possible, so a 9800X 3D CPU, the fastest RAM possible, and a Gen 5 motherboard. But of course, that makes sense because it's eliminating bottlenecks, but many of us don't have hardware quite that powerful. For example, my main workstation computer, which I mainly use for video editing, has a 5900X, which is stuck on AM4. And yes, it's got 64 gigs of RAM, but again, that's DDR4, running at 3200 megahertz, so it's not as powerful, or anywhere near as powerful actually, as what the tech reviewers are using. And my other computer, which is AM5, is more of a budget build. It has a B650 motherboard, it's got a Ryzen 7600 CPU, which is just 6 cores, and it's got 32 gigs of RAM. And yes, it's 6000 MHz and CL30, but again, that's slower than actually the RAM that the tech reviewers used. So I'm kind of interested to actually test my new RTX 5080 on both of those systems and see which one actually performs best. So I want to start out with 3D Mark, the Steel Nomad test, and in general I'm doing gaming tests and put them side by side, you don't need to go back and forth, but here you can actually see my AM4 based system gets a score of 7875, which is less than the 8153 score that you actually see with my AM5 based system. So even though there's half the cores and also half the RAM, you know, you're actually getting better results here, so that probably is the benefit of having AM5 and DDR5. For now, let's jump into gaming tests with Hogwarts Legacy, and I did this at 4K, rendering internally at 1440p via DLSS quality. Everything else is completely maxed out, so completely ultra as you can see there, and ray tracing is turned on. And in-game itself, there's no real difference whatsoever. Obviously the FPS rates are going to jump around, but you can see the average FPS rates are pretty similar on both systems, and I'll always have my DDR5 based system on the left and my DDR4 one on the right, as you can see there. Unfortunately, this doesn't show minimum FPS rates because I was having loads of issues actually showing that, but later on my tests do actually show the, you know, minimum and maximum FPS rates as well, so don't worry about that. In Hogwarts Legacy, no real difference. Next we come to Metro Exodus. And if I go into the settings, the graphical settings, I went for 4K, extreme quality, no VSync or anything like that. And on both systems, it was, again, fairly similar. I think the 7600 sometimes edged it slightly by 1 or 2 FPS, but really they were both fairly similar. The GPU was, you know, maxed out or close to being maxed out here, above 95, and the CPU was not, so we weren't being CPU bottlenecked or anything like that. But in general, they both performed fairly well, as you can see there. I had no major issues with either, but I do think the average FPS rate was slightly higher on the 7600 by around 4 or 5 frames on average, but you know, there was nothing significantly different either. I did repeat all these tests multiple times, but yeah, this is what I seen was fairly similar, but the DDR5 system being slightly ahead. Now we come to Battlefield, and for this I went with 4K resolution and everything completely maxed out at ultra. DLSS was off, so we're looking at native rendering. I did have ray tracing turned off, but other than that, everything was jacked up to the max. And when we actually look at the games, unfortunately I end up with a different level, and I also couldn't get the overlay working on my DDR5 based system, which was a complete pain due to all the DRM in Battlefield and things like that. But in general, the average FPS rates were lower in my DDR5 based system, but that's actually due to a CPU bottleneck. A game like Battlefield is very demanding on the CPU. As you can see on my 12 core system, the CPU usage is often above 50%, so that's probably what's holding back the Ryzen 7600 build. But in general, still good FPS rates considering this is native 4K. Now we come to Assassin's Creed Mirage, quite a good looking game. I went with 4K rendering and maxed out all the graphics there. There's no DLSS on or anything like that, just TAA for anti-aliasing. And you can see it's pretty much the same. Obviously, you're always going to get very slight variation, but in general, yeah, things are looking pretty good here. The same FPS rate really on both of them, and the GPU is the thing that's being pushed the most. And while the CPU usage is sometimes a little bit high, you know, 60 or 70%, you know, even a 6-core Ryzen 7600 will perform the same as the 12-core 5900X. You can see there, you know, things are GPU bottlenecked and not CPU bottlenecked. If we skip forward a little bit, you can actually see some jittering and jumping there, and actually I did notice that a little bit more with my DDR4 based system. I mentioned that at the start as well, but it's something I'll come back to throughout this video. Is in general, if we look at the frame graph there, It's not as smooth with my 5900X and my DDR4 based system. I get more peaks and troughs, lower 1% lows and lower 0.1% lows as well. So in general, while the average FPS rate is fairly similar, I was getting a slightly smoother and better experience with my Ryzen 7600 DDR5 based system. Next up, I wanted to try out Cyberpunk at 4K native resolution. So if I go over to the video tab, it's 4K there, and I got a high preset, and then I've turned off DLSS and frame generation. So everything is just high, and what we're gonna see in a minute is actually the native rendering on 4K. And actually, they're both pretty similar. The GPU usage is 95 or above, so that's kind of the thing that's being maxed out. The CPU usage isn't holding us back, as you can see there. And often the FPS rates are around the same. I got the feeling that the 7600 system, my DDR5 based one, was maybe slightly better and slightly smoother, but there wasn't much in it at all. If we now look at Cyberpunk with everything maxed out, what I did here was stay at 4K, but then ultimately went to the ray tracing overdrive, so the maximum possible settings, but I had DLSS on and also the frame generation too. But actually it looked pretty amazing and it performed really well on both systems. So yes, this is being upscaled from 1440p, but it looked absolutely brilliant. And again, there's not much in it in terms of the actual FPS rate. I did again get the feeling that maybe my Ryzen 7600 system was slightly better, but there wasn't much in it. But obviously my CPU usage was higher with my 6-core system, so there might be some times in Cyberpunk where that could become an issue when you start getting worse FPS rates and worse 1% lows, but certainly for this bit of the game, things were fairly similar. Next up, Guardians of the Galaxy. So with this one, I also went with 4K, I whacked everything up to the max, went with ray tracing and everything else, and this is again at 4K. And you can see here that both systems are performing fairly well. You know, the GPU is the main bottleneck here, and the FPS rates as a whole are pretty similar. So again, no major issues, although I think probably, again, my AM5 based system is doing slightly better, but nothing really to write home about either. If we skip ahead a little bit now, you can see again that the GPU is the main thing that's maxed out, and the FPS rates are still better on my AM5 based system, and that's borne out in the actual benchmarks as well. As you can see there, so the average FPS rates are better. There was a little spike at the start, and hence the minimum FPS rates are looking a lot lower, but I usually get that on all of my systems, to be honest. In general though, the DDR5 based system did better. Now let's finally look at Red Dead Redemption 2. And for this I went with 4K, DLSS was off and everything was maxed out to ultra, other than particle quality and tessellation quality because I forgot to hike them, but there's no DLSS or anything else, and we can see here they both perform fairly well. But again, it was a case that my AM5 based system just seemed to be a little bit smoother, and we'll see that in a minute when we actually look at the final benchmark results. But the average FPS rate here does look like it's pretty much the same. And again, the GPU usage is above 95%. So it's the GPU is the limiting factor here, really. But the game, again, performed really well. And this is native 4K, so a very good result. Let's skip forward now, though, because I don't like the next bit. But this is the actual end of the benchmark results. And you can see that although the average FPS rates were very similar, the AM5 based system did perform better when it came to 1% lows and also the maximum FPS rate. So there's no major difference really. I mean, things were very slightly smoother with my Ryzen 7600 system, the DDR5 one, which is kind of interesting because everything is half. You know, I've got half the CPU cores, I've got half the RAM, and I also have two NVMe drives in my AM4 based build, but I've only got the one NVMe drive in my budget AM5 build. But actually the AM5 build did really well, and you could see often while the average FPS rate was the same, things were often a bit smoother, so it had better minimum FPS and better maximum FPS rates as well. So that's actually pretty interesting, at least to me, but other than that there was no real difference. So I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please click the thumbs up button and please subscribe to see more videos like this. Thanks for watching.